2017 meeting of Jenkintown Borough Council. Thank you very much for coming, and if folks want to come and try to speak in the room, please do. Mayor, would you give us some pledge to the flag?
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Before we do our roll call, we are going to have a swearing in of our two newly appointed council members, Anne Cathy and Jennifer Luber. And Mr. Mayor, would you be honest?
I would be pleased to do an honors.
Do we have any members of the press here with cameras? Oh, there you are. Hi. You're so tall. How could I miss you? We'd like to get a picture, so where is the best place? Just like maybe right here?
If you like.
Yeah.
The only place. In this chair?
Yeah, he's standing up.
Yeah.
We just don't want to get the picture of the back of your head.
Oh, sure. I'll ask you to put your right hand in the air, your left hand on the Bible if you wish to swear. Yeah. And repeat after me. I am McCaffrey. Do solemnly swear. That I will support, obey, and defend. The Constitution of the United States. And the Constitution of this Commonwealth. And that I will discharge the duties of my office. With fidelity. Congratulations, Anne. I, Jennifer Luber. Do solemnly swear. That I will support, obey, and defend. The Constitution of the United States. And the Constitution of this Commonwealth. And I will discharge the duties of my office. With fidelity. Congratulations.
Live streaming.
Councilor Danilak.
Is excused.
President Zanko.
Here.
Councilor Luber.
Here.
Oh no.
Councilor Bolden.
Here.
Councilor McQuillan.
Present.
Councilor Young.
Present.
Councilor Whitley.
Present.
Councilor Sokusiak.
Here.
I'm the president of the forum.
Thank you very much. And now we will go slightly out of order. And I would like to turn your attention to the order of business that's on the second side of the agenda sheet. To item number 5. And I move to appoint Ronald Eulery. Is that
words about Ron, Madam President, if you will. Ron's been with the force since 2013. He's been an excellent employee. He's a graduate of ITT Tech with an associate's degree in computer engineering. Ron works, he's done a fine job for us since he started with us, and I'm proud to add him to the full-time force. And Madam President, I would ask the mayor if you would please swear me, if you will.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
We're happy to have you with us full-time. Yeah.
Appreciate it. Let's go over here.
Oh, we should vote before we swear in. Sweet oversight there. Are there any additional questions or comments? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Let the record show you now.
Ronald, you raise your right hand. I, Ronald Euler, do solemnly swear that I will support, obey, and defend the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of this Commonwealth, and that I will discharge the duties of my office
with
fidelity. Congratulations.
Madam President,
yes.
I also want to mention that Maxine Marlowe is in the audience. She's a member of the Civil Service Commission.
Yes. Hi, Maxine.
Hi.
And we want to thank her and the commission for all the work they did with this project.
Yes. Thank you very much. We appreciate the service of the Civil Service Commission.
And invoices totaling $196,247.26.
Do I hear a second? Okay. Any questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, now we have time for public comment, and there are a large number of people in the room, so I'm going to ask those of you who have public comment to please limit your comments to 3 minutes or less. Also, I would encourage, if somebody has said what you really want to say, to just, you know, and if you feel it's necessary to speak, just say that you agree with the previous speaker and not repeat everything. And I do note that these proceedings are being recorded, video and audio recorded. So I just want people in the room to know that. And I believe, is it correct that this is being live streamed?
It is being live streamed through Facebook.
Okay. And so I also want to note that we can't take questions and comments from people who are not in the room. Okay. Yes, and would you please stand and state your name and your address?
Yes, my name is Danielle Downs, and I live at 221 Runnymede Avenue. I was born here, and I've been here ever since. But I would like to ask a question. At the January 9th meeting, Mr. Locke had mentioned something about a violation being given to my neighbor at 303 Runnymede, and I just want to know the status of that violation.
I think we don't have time to do a question and answer period. So what you're requesting is to have the status of the property at, I think it's 303 Runnymede, updated, and We will make time for that within the course of the meeting.
Thank you.
Yes.
I'm Molly Donini from Cedar Street, Jenkintown, and I'm here representing, I have a lot of petitions here all signed for the property that was...
Can you state your address again, I'm sorry?
431 Cedar.
Okay.
Right next to the property that the borough bought. And I was wondering just what was going to happen to the property, what consideration you're given and given to the neighbors, because none of us knew anything about it. We thought it was done very undercover. And it was all by word of mouth what we heard. So I'd like to know what you plan to do with it, or if it can be, it's a historical house, I think. It's a shame to really take it down.
Okay. So,
Will you rehab the house?
Again, I think that what we'll do is we'll make a time to give a full report on that in the agenda of the meeting, because we're not gonna have a back and forth question and answer period for the public comment. Okay? Thank you. Are there any others?
Over here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Thomas Oliver, 406 Runnymede Avenue. I have concerns also about the Cedar Street happening rather quickly as far as in the public eye. I know I was on council for 20 years, and if most people heard all the things you hear, you're pretty much, you know, on the end of what's going on, and make a wise decision accordingly. One thing I think should be taken into consideration is you're losing, you know, if you're taking it off the rent rolls, you're losing income. You're putting a park in the middle of the street, you know, in the middle of a block, the people didn't buy their houses, they had a park next door. You also have the baseball field right down the street. So I think you're losing taxables, everything's, getting more and more expensive. I've been, understanding the money that the borough spent on the parking and helping the infrastructure of the town. Because some of that money comes back in businesses and all, I have no idea where this is going, except to get rid of some problem that you may perceive or whatever. And I think there's so many people flipping houses and fixing them up again to maintain the taxables on the road. I just, without having further background and everything happening in the dark, it's a little upsetting.
Okay. Thank you for that comment, and we'll make a public statement about it when we get to the agenda. Yes.
Hello, I'm Trish Breslin-Miller. I live at 507 Rodman Avenue. Thank you all for your service to us. I, too, am dismayed of the decision to purchase the property. I have a couple of background things. One is that I sat on the board for over a year, so planning commission for 2035. For Jenkintown. So imagine my surprise.
Sorry, that was
imagine my surprise when nothing was mentioned about purchasing property. We have gone through every aspect of a town and going forward from now through the year 2035 and beyond. And many of us have been meeting for 18 months or so to discuss this and have sent out surveys and had public meetings asking for input from borough residents. And then all that information was gathered and then put in order in a way that quantified what people wanted. I know that acquiring of that space was not only not mentioned, but it wasn't even, an immediate priority. So that was my first really upsetting part about that. The second thing I'd like to say is, as I've been told in the last couple of days through social media, that all of this was done at these public meetings. And I will note that both of the public meetings that this was voted on were meetings of special meetings. So they weren't the regular borough monthly meeting like this is. They were both special meetings. And the way that you let us know was not through the emails that we have all asked to be on the email list no notification to your public that way, and no notification to this day on your website. Nothing. So I wonder if everyone wants to raise, if they happen to be a person that reads the Intelligencer on a regular basis and reads public notices in the Intelligencer. Anybody?
There wasn't any.
All right, you have four or five people. So the rest of us probably signed up for email, thinking that maybe that's how we would be notified. That there was a public meeting, and that, secondly, you could also have used your own website to let us know. So I think we have every right to question this money being spent. I think we have every right to question what's going to happen. Again, being someone on a planning commission, and for over a year, nothing has been mentioned of this. I think it, to me, and maybe you're going to give me all kinds of information tonight that I don't know, I just think it's irresponsible to take our money and spend it with no plan and no no plan.
Thank you, Church.
Are there other public comments?
Yes. Are you said to me or someone else?
Okay, this is them. Peggy Downs, 301 Runnymede. Just, I've been here for months because I've been having an issue on Runnymede Avenue. Not everybody's aware, but many are. I just want to publicly state that I'm personally kind of disappointed and feel kind of let down by our borough manager, our borough solicitor, and borough council at large, based on the events of the last 5 months. And the reason I'm saying that publicly is because I thought that these people represented us and were fighting for our best interests, but I feel that's not been the case. In fact, I kind of feel contrary in some regards. So the bottom line is I'm not understanding why code enforcement is so difficult and why this has been something that has been, so there's a business running next door to us, and we've asked the borough manager to step up and enforce the code as stipulated in a residential area. So pretty much what we've gotten, and I understand that we need to be very specific about how we enforce that code to ensure the legality of it and ensure that it goes through okay. But for the most part, what's happened is the borough manager expressed at the last meeting that approximately $19,000 to date from that last meeting, the BZR meeting, was spent conferring with the solicitor and the firm and finding ways to state why it's hard to prove why that business operation doesn't exist at 303. And we feel strongly that the borough manager and the borough solicitor have made this more about us. Like, it really has come down to a reflection of us kind of being put on the spot, made to feel really uncomfortable. They seem to want to find fault and reason or blame us for why things are happening. And you would think that by asking for the code to be enforced and thereby protecting the integrity of our homes and our property values, you would think that the manager and the solicitor would want to collaborate with us and help to ensure that we're all working together as one cohesive team, not only just with us, but also with the offender, the glass residence at 303 Runnymede. And this has been far from being the case at all. Like I said, we've just been met with a lot of resistance. In fact, I'm going to say that at the BZR meeting on the 9th, there were a couple people who hadn't been in attendance at prior meetings, and they stated that they were kind of concerned that the borough manager seemed to express, he seemed to show no, basically no respect for us. And I apologize for that, George, because I keep trying to work with you. But again, I just am citing an observation that was made publicly to me after the meeting. Anyway, I feel that if the code had been enforced in the very beginning in August when I addressed this, I don't think that we would be standing here tonight. And I have problems believing that a lot of that, the excuses for why the code wasn't enforced are necessarily hold a lot of water. Anyway, from the very first day, the borough manager and the borough solicitor have tried to spout this as a neighborly spat that I'm having with my next door neighbor. Mm-hmm. Please allow me to continue. I'm almost done. And
no, I'm sorry, but I have to go by these guidelines that we set out in the beginning of the meeting. So thank you. Thank you for your statement. Yes.
Good to be back.
Yeah.
Lori Durkin, 205 Runnymede Avenue. I just wanted to share two statements. I was asked to speak on this first issue. I had the privilege of serving on Borough Council for 8 years, and I submitted my resignation on November 18th, 2016. Honestly, 2016 was a very difficult year for me on council. I stood pretty much on my own on my positions on 303 Runnymede Avenue, the position that Peggy just spoke about, on my opposition to the Cedar Street property, ongoing the scope and pace of our property maintenance efforts throughout the borough, and also of the raise given to manager Locke. So when President Panko and Vice President Bunker informed me on November 18th that they were replacing me as chair, I realized that I could no longer be successful in the work that I wanted to do, and that I, whether I was a rank and file or a chair, that my voice was done. I have been actively engaged in community service for over 30 years in the borough. I continue to serve on the Jenkintown Community Alliance, and I will certainly continue to do good work, I hope, throughout the borough. And particularly try to generate more interest in our local council selections and broadening our field of candidates. To the rank and file members of council, and particularly to Kieran Farrell, who stepped up to take the BZR position, I know it's hard work and I appreciate that. And to the leadership, I simply lost faith in your stewardship. I also want to just make a comment, since it's been brought up on social media, regarding the votes for approval of the Cedar Street acquisition. There were two votes on Cedar Street. The initial was purchasing property at a special meeting on September 8th. I was unable to attend that meeting. The second vote was authorizing funding on November 9th. So why didn't I vote against that motion at that meeting? There were many executive sessions held during the Cedar Street purchase, and I argued vigorously and repeatedly against this purchase. Ultimately, a straw vote was held, and at least 10 of our 12 members of council were in favor of the purchase. So I failed to make my case, and it was clear that council was going to move forward. Since council approval was a given, I then argued for a professional plan to be developed, including overall concepts, costs, and funding sources. That plan was not produced. My main concern then became the investment in the property would mean that dollars would not be available for the number one priority of the comprehensive plan, which was town center revitalization. I attended the November 9th budget workshop meeting to present my request for the revitalization dollars. The meeting was advertised to the public as, Jenkintown Borough Council will conduct workshops in order to discuss the 2017 budget on October 24th and November 19th and November 21st. The budget will be adopted in December 21st, and these meetings are open to the public. Now, you might wonder if that really is an invitation to public input. The evening prior to the November 9th budget meeting, the council president sent out an email urging councils to attend this important budget meeting, but to the best of my knowledge, there was no prior notice for council meetings to take place. May I finish my last paragraph?
I'm sorry.
She can have my few minutes.
Thank you.
When I arrived at the November 9th budget meeting, the meeting began as a regular council meeting.
I would invite you to submit your comments in writing if you've got them typed out, but we need to go to the guidelines.
She can have my 3 minutes. I will.
She can have mine.
She can have mine too.
And mine.
Thank you for letting me be heard. I do appreciate that.
I will go 3 more minutes with you.
Thank you. When I arrived, I was stunned when the meeting began as a regular council meeting with a roll call, pledge of allegiance, etc. This had never occurred at a budget workshop in the 8 years I served on council. The vote was called, and I did not have any paperwork on the motion before me, and my immediate assumption was that I messed up, that I didn't get the information, and that I was wrong. Knowing that the motion would pass nearly unanimously, I worried that if I voted against it, it would be interpreted as a, you know, an aggressive act, and I would jeopardize my revitalization funding. So I froze, and I didn't speak up. I wish I had made a different decision in that moment, but the inference that I supported the acquisition of the in 2016 and have now done a 180 to be against it is simply dishonest and intended to embarrass me. After that vote, I became truly concerned about the lack of transparency. I did speak with two attorneys who specialize in municipal law to ask them about the manner in the vote that this took place. Essentially, both of them said that it was not legitimate. Thank you for your time.
Is there anyone else?
no, it's not question and answer. Hi, I'm Kate Pettis. I live at 210 Hillside Avenue. And I realize this is not a question and answer, that it's just comment. But I have questions, and I'm hoping these questions will be answered when you cover whatever you're doing. Thanks, sorry, Jay. The one question that I feel very strongly about to be answered is that, was it ever determined, okay, I was hoping to ask a question, now I sort of have to get my head together. Sorry, everyone. So what I've heard is that you've purchased these properties and you're going to knock them down and make them a park. And we will lose $9,000 to the school on property taxes. So that's just the start, is $9,000 every single year we no longer have. So forever, we no longer have that $9,000. And the hope is that property values in the surrounding homes will rise. Was it ever determined how high the properties have to rise in order to cover that $9,000? But not just the $9,000, the debt payment, because we borrowed $250,000. Mm-hmm. And I hear the plan is to borrow an additional $250,000. And we're looking at grants, but it's my understanding that municipal grants are a matching thing. So a grant isn't, they're going to pay for everything, they're going to pay for part of it. So there are more dollars coming out of our borough budget going to this open space. And any way I run numbers, I don't see how this fiscally benefits the borough. I see only dollars going down for the borough. It's nice to have open spaces, but we do have a very large playground. We've got tennis courts and basketball courts. We've got the town square. There's plenty of green space in Jenkintown. There are large backyards in most homes. So I'm confused. Why would we be on purpose losing dollars forever? Because we'll always have to care for this property. We're always going to lose that property taxes. We'll have the debt service for, I don't know, 20, 30 years. I don't know what it was that you made the debt on, but $500,000, I imagine you're not going to pay off in 10 years. So I'm looking at 20, 30 years for the debt service. How does this feed back into borough funds? Personally, I think that's why we have council, is to make sure we have funds, not to deplete our funds, but to increase our funds. And I don't think the property, I would like to know by how much the properties need to rise in order to cover that. That's the only question I want. I have more. Sorry, thank you. Maybe I'll raise my hand again later.
Okay. Other questions? Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name's Pat Hart. I'm a resident of about 25 years.
Say your address.
79 Runnymede. I know some of the folks have interacted, but I in no way have the credentials that many of these people have who stood up. And I truthfully admit to all you folks who have given your time to Jenkintown to serve on this council. I thank you for your service, but I have to say, I feel shocked. I don't know what's going on. The last couple of times I came, it was because there were robberies on Runnymede. But all of a sudden, I'm not gonna take my 3 minutes, I'm just gonna make a simple statement. I'm gonna tell you how from my heart I feel. I'm all of a sudden feeling for the first time in my existence here where shady doesn't mean supplying trees. Shady seems to support something else that has me very, very concerned. These are people who served for obviously cumulative decades. What could their possible other motive be other than the good of Jenkintown? I'm very concerned. Thank you.
Yes.
My name is Jeanette Rawls. I live in the house directly in front of 433. I've been there for 60 years, and I feel that we were owed an explanation for the purchase of that property and what it's being used for.
You want to step in for the room?
Yes.
Okay.
My name is Eric Montroy. I live at 502 Summit Ave. I'm here to speak in support of the decision to develop properties on Cedar Ave. I think before I moved to Jenkintown, I've been here for about 8 years. I lived in two places that made the mistake during the 70s and 80s of not developing green space. And then in the 2000s, when I was living there, they recognized the mistake that was made, desperately tried to develop green space for the community, recognizing how valuable that kind of opportunity is. In Jenkintown, it seems to me that the opportunity to develop green space, be it a community garden, be it a park, is very limited. There just isn't a lot of land. And recognizing how green space helps a community, not only economically, but also just sort of existentially, I think it's extremely important that we do what I think it shows a lot of vision. And I think it's interesting that Kate mentioned the town square. I wasn't here then, but I had some friends that were on council at the time, and I know that there was a huge fight about developing the town square, and see where we are today. I mean, people really cherish that space, and I think it's you guys have shown great vision by purchasing the property, and I know a lot of other people in Jenkintown feel the same way. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's go 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah, I'm John Kroll. I live at 424 Cedar Street, directly across from where the property was purchased. And I also would like to know what the intentions are for that property. And quite frankly, I don't really mind a green space. I'm not for putting in like rental properties there, I think it'll become a real problem. Jenkintown already has a lot of rental houses, and people want to come to Jenkintown for our school. And people come from outside of Jenkintown, and I just wouldn't like to see, like rental properties go up there because I have to live across the street from whoever moves in. Thank you.
Thank you for your statement. Number two.
My name is Adrienne Redd. I chair the Jenkintown Environmental Advisory Committee.
Oh, could you say your address, please?
It's 442 Leadham Street.
And so, stand up, please.
So the children on Leadham Street and Cedar Street, there are many children in that area, and I think they would be greatly benefited by having a green space. I think this gentleman made a really excellent point that it serves the well-being of the neighborhood and the borough as a whole to have a green space. And if there were condos there, with regard to the concern about loss of revenue to the school district, each additional child living in condos would cost the school district an additional $20,000. So that doesn't seem like the best use of the space. It seems to me like a once-in-a-lifetime chance to add green space. And it seems to me that the improvement of the quality of life, which is part of what the borough is charged with advancing, and the better management of stormwater runoff with a green space rather than a highly dense area would be better, and that the children would be safer if they had a place to play. That end of town has almost no green space for unstructured play at all. And those all seem like really great benefits. And certainly we can throw open the process so that people who are concerned who live adjacent to the property can put exactly what they want there. That's something that seems like we can have a conversation about as a community.
Thank you, Rick. Great. Yeah. Sherry Knightage, 111 Wallet Street. I didn't, fully know all of the ins and outs, and I hear what people are saying. The way that it was handled probably wasn't the best way. And I don't know if there was like a timeliness issue where there was a quick turnaround and things like that for, sale property. But I did
look at the property, and I went there, and it's a big property that would certainly lend itself to an apartment building or condos or something like that, which I think would be a concern, and has, you know, some rental issues have caused problems in the schools. And so I think that, yes, I think everybody of the oppositions, I hear that makes a lot of sense of why people are upset about it. But I also think that seizing the opportunity and then kind of seeing what you're going to do with it, I think it would have been a shame to lose the opportunity for that big of a property and to just, you know, maybe lose control of what could happen to it. So, you know, hopefully lesson learned, maybe next time you would handle it differently, but I do think it's a good opportunity.
Thank you. And number four. Lisa Perkins from 316 Greenwood Avenue, and I'm actually standing to shift gears back to carrying the torch for 301 Runnymede. From the very first day, the borough manager and the borough solicitor have tried to make this into a neighborly spat issue, and it's not. We're simply expecting that a business operation should not be run out of a residential property per established code. Code enforcement has nothing to do with neighborly spats. In fact, we're of the belief that the borough has exacerbated the issue tremendously by involving us to the degree that they have, instead of dealing with the issue from the get-go. The borough solicitor is the one who advised us to get cameras that would show the loading and unloading of business material, and so we did that. In fact, over the course of these last 5 months, the borough manager and the borough solicitor are the ones who have advised us and instructed us about what specific next steps we should take and the material that we should provide to the borough in order for the borough to cite the business owner. In the most recent notice of violation, there are several references to a complainant. Why is this a notice from the borough advising violation notices? It is important or necessary to cite that the reason that this is being issued is because a neighbor expects it? Isn't it the job of the borough manager to enforce code, and isn't it fair that the supposed complainant expects that the integrity of their neighborhood should remain residential as coded? Also, isn't it unfair that the borough manager would deflect his responsibilities and cast blame on the issuance of a notice of violation onto a complainant? Why is it necessary to state that the evidence came from a complainant when that is exactly what the borough advised us to do? At the November BZR meeting, the borough solicitor advised us that the only reason they have not yet cited this business is because they didn't want to make it harder for us, the neighbors, given the business's propensity to carry on inappropriately. Of course, the meeting minutes did not recite that statement, although there are several neighbors here who will attest to such. In any case, this business has been acting out of his disorderly fashion a lot lately, and in his rants, he is threatening to sue us. We, as advised by the police chief, called the police finally on Friday morning 1:13. The police responded and we were advised that a citation would be issued. We requested a meeting with the chief to discuss the heightened obscenity-riddled rants by the business. The police chief advised us at that meeting that the citation had actually not been issued at the direction of the solicitor. The solicitor advised that these rants do not constitute disorderly conduct, as the business is directing the rant at our house and specifically at our cameras. It was stated that the business is not in public when he is doing this, and because we are not standing on our front sidewalk when he is yelling at us, it's acceptable. Further, referring back to the start of this issue, the borough manager... I have to ask you to stop. Thank you.
I'm Randy Garbin. I live at 99 Runnymede, and I'm with regards to this park, nobody doesn't love a park. Nobody doesn't love green space. I think there isn't a person in the room that doesn't acknowledge how nice they are and how they contribute to our health and our existential well-being. Well, what I think everyone in this room hates is a government that acts without accountability. And the fact that we are a tiny town, we are 4,500 people, and the borough doesn't see fit to send out, I don't know, a tweet, a letter, an email, anything to tell us 5-6 months ago that this was even on the agenda? I'm going back and looking through the minutes, and I see nothing about this. In fact, I don't even see any minutes. There's no minutes from the last council meeting, and I realize that everyone's busy, but this is fundamental. You are committing the borough to spending a lot of money. For a long time. And you are also hurting the school district, which means we pay two masters and they are both going to charge us for this. I would love to see a park there too, but maybe, just maybe, you should start a campaign to raise private money to buy this. And, you know, save us a heck of a lot of money. And name the park after that fine person. But I don't think we need this. We're too small. We're not even a square mile. There are towns that are several square miles and probably have less green space per capita than Jenkintown does, if you include the school system, the schoolyards, and not to mention all the parks that we don't own outside of Jenkintown. I really don't think we need this. And by the way, no one's mentioned it, but there's also word that you're turning this into a dog park. I don't know if that's the case, but I hope not, especially for the sake of the people who live near it. But that's pretty much all I have to say, and I hope you do the right thing. And if you've already bought it, good time to sell.
Yes. Hi, Joanne Tracy, 215 Runnymede Avenue. I've been to several of the meetings regarding the 303 property. So, just two comments. As far as being the profanity in public display, I mean, I see the kids living on Runnymede. We see the children from Jenkintown School. You know, everybody's kids walking along Runnymede Avenue, so they would be certainly exposed to the foul language. So that's, you know, that's worrisome. And also the log splitting has continued to go on at this house too. So I was wondering the status of that, if that could be commented on with the other comments for Runnymede Avenue. Yes. Thank you.
Can't make this stuff up.
Thank you. Anyone else in the vestibule?
Yeah. My name is Ryan Downs, 301 Runnymede. I was the one who called the police on that Friday that was spoken about for the 303 property. He was directing his rants at me. It was F you, he was giving me the finger. I felt, I was afraid. That's why I called the police. I was afraid. I know that he is a convicted felon. I know that he has a short fuse. I don't know what he's gonna do. And he was directing that at me. Now, the solicitor made that assumption that he was directing it towards the cameras and or the house. But I'm telling you that it was directed at me, and that's why there's no citation issued. Now, I want to know, I'm concerned about that. How do you make that assumption? And if the park does go into the Cedar Street property, so that I'm linking these together now, if the park does go into the Cedar Street property, how are you going to restrict people from cursing at the kids? What if he decides to move there? You're just not going to do anything about it because, hey, that's public. He's allowed to speak whatever he wants. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Any other comments or comments from citizens?
Any comments back there?
Any comments?
Luke Stanovich, 423 Cedar. The thing that concerns me is, I know it hasn't been transparent how the property was purchased, but how do we know that we paid a fair price for the property? So that's a part of it too.
Anyone else? Yes.
Andrew Smith, 200 Hillside Avenue in Jenkintown. Just to address your issue. they paid a very reasonable price.
Okay.
It was, I'm the top selling real estate agent in the community. The price that they paid was well under market. My understanding is that the owners preferred to sell it to the borough at an under market price. And if I'm not mistaken, that they approached the borough directly through their agent. I wasn't the agent, I wasn't involved in the transaction. I do know that if the borough had not purchased the property, it would have been sold to a developer there would have been houses in all likelihood put up. That, you can argue both ways how that affects us. It probably would have been good for property value, probably would have been good for tax revenue, but the opportunity to have green space, there, I mean, you could always argue against it, because when is there a good time ever to diminish the tax base, or when is there a good time ever to expend money? I'm not necessarily for it, I'm not necessarily against it, but I do know that the price that they paid was, from a taxpayer's perspective, they did a good job as far as the price they paid.
I see it's a big lot, so I understand that.
Yeah.
So make a profit.
Any other, yes.
Hi, Molly Durkin, 205 Runnymede. I was at those properties recently, and they are in quite a state of disrepair. I understand that they are not fit to be rented. And from what I understand, there are codes that are intended to prevent that from happening to properties in Jenkintown. If you go over to the properties, there's holes in the roofs, they're not up to any sort of code, they're falling apart. And I think it speaks to the issue of the lack of enforcement of the codes in Jenkintown, which ties in with the 303 Runnymede issue, and I'd like to know why those codes aren't being enforced.
Thank you for your comment. Yes.
Jean Romano, 202 Runnymede Avenue. Is there going to be like a committee, like are we going to be informed when we do figuring out how much this park is going to cost us? And are we going to be all involved, or, you know, is it going to be in the papers? Yeah, so we can be informed and see if we really, you know, we shouldn't have this park, or we should have this park. How much is it going to cost the township? That's what I'd like to know.
Maybe others said that it's going to be a park. Or
yeah, we don't know. But is it going to cost too much? Is there a limit to how much we can not spend? I mean, or do we just like, oh, let's just buy it? I would just like to know that, to be open.
Thank you. Anyone else? Anybody else out in the viewer? Okay. I think that we will close public comment at this time, and what I will do is start by sharing with you some thoughts and a statement that we have put together regarding the Cedar Street property. So, let me just locate that. And one of the things as a council that we are working on is how to get more information out to the public. So your concerns about lack of information, lack of tweeting, lack of, you know, posting on Facebook, partly I think that we will use our email blast system to disseminate information, and that many people have come to rely on that. I don't know if anyone around the circle is interested in tweeting information from the borough, but to date, our feeling has been that social media has not been the best way to communicate, and so we'll rely on more traditional ways and our email blasts.
By law, we have to advertise in the paper.
Oh, we have to, yes, absolutely. We have to advertise in print media, paper, yeah. But in any case, here's a public statement that we have been putting together. So during the summer of 2016, Jenkintown Borough was approached by the owner of 433 and 435 Cedar Street in Jenkintown. He was in the process of selling the property, which is a double lot with two houses and 17 garages on the lot, and had been approached by real estate developers who planned to construct 6 units of dense housing. The owner did not care for that plan and approached the borough, offering to sell the property for a price significantly lower than market value. The borough borough gave some consideration to this and then decided that we needed, and because this was a matter of real estate, some of that discussion was held in executive session, after which, as a council, we came out of executive session and then agreed to do due diligence, and the borough contracted with qualified firms and commissioned a comprehensive property appraisal, environmental study, property inspection. At a public meeting on September 8th, 2016, borough council voted unanimously to approve the purchase of the property pursuant to the Pennsylvania Borough Code. On November 9th, 2016, again by unanimous vote at a public meeting, borough council voted to borrow $250,000 from Republic Bank for a term of 15 years to purchase this property. In doing so, the debt service fund that the borough currently has receives 0.88 mils, and that millage currently pays for our general obligation note. The general obligation note was recently refinanced and reduced the interest rate that was negotiated, which reduced the annual cost of the obligation note. And the amount that that note was reduced corresponded with the amount that we needed to borrow for this property. And so that has allowed the purchase of the property with no increase to the taxpayer. This borough only owns one other community park space, Town Square. Although there is lots of land surrounding the school, the school district is in control of that land and that public playground. So though through public surveys and information sessions that were held as part of the Jenkintown 2035 comprehensive plan, which was the plan that Trish mentioned when she stood up and spoke. It was a year-long plan collecting input at a public meeting that was held at the school, and then a group of people met over monthly over the course of actually about a year and a half, chaired very ably by Laurie Durkin. And that group identified needs and ideas that have been compiled into, at this point it's just a draft. We are using the services of the Montgomery County Planning Commission to put that plan together. And in that plan, residents and business owners declared a desire for pocket parks and open space.
That's false.
It is true that those things were not flagged as highest priority. And this group, our Jenkintown Borough, when we had this opportunity to obtain open space, took that opportunity. Somebody used the word seized the opportunity, even though it was not our highest priority according to the comprehensive plan. By the way, that comprehensive plan is still in the process of adoption. It has not yet been adopted, and so it still has several steps to go through until its adoption. The Jenkintown Environmental Action Committee has been working for the past 2 years to identify other parcels around the borough that would accommodate small parks or seating areas, and that group is supportive of this Cedar Street purchase. Presented with an offer to purchase the property below market value, the forward thinking, which was $250,000, this forward-thinking borough council considered it a wise decision for the future of the community. Although there will be a revenue loss, approximately $9,000 a year, and primarily in school taxes, this represents about 0.06 of the school's budget. And our view was that adding 6 housing units would have increased population density and may have added several more children and the associated costs to the school enrollment. The borough will continue to gather public input on the property and on the existing structures, and we are planning for the space's best use. We will be applying for grant funding to create and maintain a space that will improve the health and welfare of the Jenkintown community for years to come. There are several council members who have volunteered to chair the work group that will public input, and the EAC has volunteered to turn its next meeting, which is Wednesday, February 15th, is that correct? Over to some gathering public input about the use of this property. At the lowest possible cost to the borough taxpayers, so through grants and through, I'm fundraising efforts, et cetera. Early ideas include a rain garden, a community garden, or an open play space. There has been no discussion of a dog park. Dispel that rumor publicly right now. That has never been in the conversation at all. And no decisions regarding the use of the property have been made. So on the one hand, we've heard comments about preserving these historic buildings. On the other hand, we hear comments about these are buildings that are ramshackled and should be torn down. And so there is still study to be done and decisions to be made about those structures that are on the property. I want to thank you all for your input so far, and I've recorded much of it, and I know the meeting is being taped. So we will definitely be taking all of that into consideration as we go forward. I think, let me just check and see if I have, I was trying to make notes as we went along. That's all I can think of right now. Mr. Mayor, do you want to add to that?
Well, I just want to confirm, is it fair to say, and I think it is, that we are really at the beginning of the process of figuring out what to do with this.
Yes.
And the next steps really are the design of that process and how those meetings work and how those are publicized to the community and how convenient those meetings are and where they take place. And the goal of this process, and I heard this from council as they discussed it almost to a man and to a woman, was that this is something that the community needs to decide. This is not for council to decide. This is an opportunity that we have. And if the opportunity turns out to be the will of the people that we flip this property and minimize our losses, then that's what happens. And the will of the community is what drives this process. Mm-hmm. It's not, the purchase has been made, but from here on out, it's all on you guys.
Mm-hmm. And just to build on that, I want to say that it was one of those opportunities where it had to be done within a certain time frame. The $250,000 cost was too good to pass up. And so we had to make a decision in a speedy manner, and we knew that the property has considerable value, and as the mayor said, that we had a backup plan that it could be sold if our plans did not pan out. We have heard, I appreciate hearing from people here in the room who feel that, you know, this is an expense that you don't think the borough can bear. I've heard just as many comments from people who some people who are here and others out on the street who support the idea of, you know, thinking about the next 20 to 30 years of our community and having this kind of open space. So all of that will be taken into consideration. And I'm glad somebody brought up the idea of the town square, because I do remember that in 1999, when I first moved to Jenkintown, there was a great deal of opposition to town square and to its purchase and to its development. And at this point in time, I don't think there's anyone in the borough who would say that that was an ill-informed decision. So at this point, I'm going to end my I'd like to invite council members to add on to what we've said, and then I think we're going to bring that part of the discussion to a close. We will be talking about it again on February 15th. Anybody want to add?
There's a lot here that needs to be discussed. All of it should be responded to. But I just want to take the opportunity to thank Lori for her service. We worked together quite a bit on a lot of things. And I think that that needs to be said.
I've been walking around the neighborhood, and I've seen you at your house and looking at the different properties and some of the people who are not feeling that they have the quality. qualifications to make statements or as much of a vested interest, but all of your opinions matter. So we really appreciate you coming, you're expressing your concerns and your support and concerns. So it's our community. So we appreciate your coming.
And one final thing, or unless anyone wants to add, it's disheartening that there's something going on in the climate where there's a general feeling, and this is my feeling, that there's a malicious intent or nefarious intent to do something that is like maybe duplicitous or backhanded or in secret. And so that's one of the things that I heard, not to say that was the only thing that I heard. So I would like to kind of express that certainly hasn't been my intent to do something that would be to the detriment of the community in any way that was malicious or self-serving or irresponsible. That doesn't mean that things haven't been done in ways that perhaps there was room for a different approach or a different process, but in terms of intention, I'd like to clarify that certainly wasn't in any of the meetings that I was a part of, anything that I heard or felt. And so I want to communicate that you know, like, we're all volunteering, my daughter's the babysitter, you know, like, I'm a teacher during the day, so it's certainly not like something that I'm going to benefit from personally. I thought about, we all tried to think about, what do we want for this community, and how do we balance all of the delicate things that we have to take into consideration, and trying to remove from that anything that was like, you know, kind of nasty. That certainly wasn't our intention. So as an apology, a humble apology, if anything that was part of this process produced that feeling, because that certainly wasn't, I don't think, ever a part of our intention.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll just say, in what may have seemed a case in moving to solid meeting opportunities to develop some or all of this property, being something that we felt would be a tangible and lasting value for our community, such as a community garden or a practice space or general open space for community use and enjoyment, you know, we may have erred in not trying harder to solicit neighborhood input, but time was of the essence, and we felt strongly that we should secure an opportunity to do something with this property. And we also assumed the potential benefits of this all would be obvious and something that we were to some degree entrusted to, you know, move on and that we would do good, because I too am saddened and disheartened to have any sense that we acted not in your best interest, because clearly that, I think, is not the case. But moving forward without a public sense of inclusive decision making has been detrimental to the community perception of this project, and I'm saddened by that. It's well known and understood that for open space development in tight residential areas, to be successful, careful planning, local empowerment, and community support are needed. So we understand there's a real and legitimate concern over the planning and development of this space and how any development may impact this tight neighborhood. The borough needs to better communicate its plans going forward, particularly where it involves public input, because community investment, or community interest rather, support and participation are imperative for anything to work. To that end, we have always planned to hold public forums for such input, and we'll ensure that those meetings are well held to cost.
Thank you.
I just have another piece of this, is that this group being here, quite frankly, is one of my favorite things. This group being here tonight is one of my favorite things about Jenkintown. People are involved, want to know what's going on, want to make sure that the best thing happens for the community. Real estate is really tough to deal with, because you can't do it publicly. If you do real estate publicly, you can put yourself in a really bad position. So there's some difficulties there. But I would urge you, this forum is very difficult to have a back and forth and share all the information. So I would urge you to talk to any of us to find out, you know, what's going on, what you don't know. And I was particularly excited or particularly happy at the tone of this, because I don't feel that there's anger. I feel there's confusion, and it's, you know, what's going on, should you do this? But I don't think there's anybody in this room who thinks that anyone up here tried to do anything that was other than in the best interest of the town.
And I will just add, because
because I feel like I'm just seeing so much nastiness on public social media, and I just really can't bring myself to sink that low to participate in that kind of exchange. I would invite any of you to phone me at any time. And I think I speak for anyone on council.
Any time during reasonable hours.
Yes, don't call. After 11, obviously. But I would invite phone calls at any time. And also email.
That is interested in getting involved with the EAC and their meetings and the public meeting that we're going to have regarding that property to definitely come out, because I think that's the best way to communicate. And I agree with the Borough. Anything you read on social media, if it sounds crazy or untrue, it probably is. So I do encourage you to get in touch with the Borough Manager, one of us, somebody on the EAC, somebody that's involved in one of these committees that are working on that property, because that's the best avenue to go down to get the truth and what's really happening. So I do encourage that. You can get all of our our Borough on the website. You can email us, and I'll be happy to give anybody my cell phone number.
And I just want to give one more status update, which is that, our current plan is this. For 2017, we are going to keep the property a status quo. And so you will probably notice that the garages will continue to be rented. The former owner is still in the one house. There is a person who's renting one of the garages who has volunteered to maintain the property with mowing grass and clearing snow for the coming year. And in the following year, we will be doing and we will begin our planning and making and doing grant applications and seeing where we're going to go with this. And then we will begin to lay those plans in order in 2018 and 19. We wanted to do this carefully and responsibly.
Deborah, I know it's not public comment time. Hey, Petit 210. I know it's not, but I have to say this about Facebook. I'm not really on Facebook, but I have to say there was a council member who was rude. So if you're saying nastiness.
I responded to innuendo and accusation.
Facebook is not on our agenda, and it's not.
It sounded like you were admonishing the public, and I thought the council should be included as well.
No, I was not admonishing
that's
the
all.
Public. I was
that's
telling
what it sounded like
my
to
stance
me.
On Facebook.
Who is receiving the rent? Who is receiving the rent from these garages now since you purchased the property? Is the borough going to receive it?
Yeah. Okay. So we're going to move on, and I would like to ask the manager if you could give an update and about the property on Runnymede.
Since the last public meeting, the time expired for an appeal on the zoning violation. So a citation was written and delivered to the district court.
So, I'm sorry, but could you just go back in history a little bit longer so I
okay.
louder so everyone can.
Since the last public meeting, there was a zoning violation issued to the tenant of 303 Runnymede for running a concrete business out of the residential property. He had 30 days to appeal that. His appeal was not timely, so a citation was written. The process of that citation is it gets delivered to the judge by the police department, and then the judge issues the citation to the person.
And so do you know what the status of that is right now?
Is it monetary? Yes, it's... the judge has the appeal would have been made to the zoning hearing board. The appeal wasn't timely, so the violation goes out. Now, the tenant is guilty of that citation. So the citation is then sent to the judge. The judge sets the amount, it's a maximum $500 fine, and she will set that during her hearing notice. I'm informed by our solicitor that she cannot set it aside or forego it, that that purview is the ZHB's. And it's past that point of being able to hear a case on it. It's actually just setting the fine.
In terms of the process?
Yeah.
I don't have anything to add in terms of the process. The judge will make a determination as to what the fine is and whether or not there are any additional consequences. Whether or not he is in violation is no longer in question. He is in violation. He did not appeal the citation, so he is in violation. So it's not like he's going to go before the court and say, I'm not in violation, I was not running a business. He has been found in violation, and he has not appealed that decision.
What is the time frame from here?
That's really up to the judge. I mean, as quickly as her court staff can get it out, I assume the citation has already been delivered to her. So as quickly as she can get it out.
Does that mean he's going to stop? Is his equipment impounded? $500 isn't a lot of money.
Well, it's a lot of money for a lot of people.
How do they set the fine? How does she determine?
He could not. The reason why his appeal was not timely is because he could not afford, essentially, the bond that he needed to post to file the appeal. He needed to post a $1,000 bond in order to file the appeal to the zoning hearing board. He did not have $1,000 to file the appeal to the zoning hearing board. So $500 is a lot of money to a lot of people.
But that's the max. How does she determine?
That's up to her.
I'm saying, so could it be like $5 to $500?
She could say no fine if she wanted to, because she's the judge. We don't have any say over that. The only thing that we will do is we will go before her and we will impress upon her that this is important to the borough, that, you know, he had been given ample opportunity to cease the operations. He did not cease the operations, and thus far we're asking for the maximum fine. But I can't say what she's going to do. I assume she's going to be fair and that she'll listen to both sides as it equates to what type of fine she decides to issue out. And I just want to make it clear that the borough, and specifically myself, as the borough solicitor, the acting borough solicitor tonight, but the representative of the firm, have never directed anyone to do anything. Questions were asked of the solicitor and of the borough manager about what the residents could bring to either the solicitor or the borough manager to show us that a business was being run, and we answered those questions. I never directed anyone to set up cameras or to videotape anybody, and neither did Manager Locke, to my knowledge. So I just want that to be clear. Information was brought to the borough, and when it rose to the level of a citation was issued.
You mentioned that we, meaning you, representing the borough, have an opportunity to speak to the judge and impress upon the judge. What is the timing of that? Is that the judge's calendar?
Yeah, she will set a hearing date.
Okay, and in that hearing are facts regarding disorderly conduct and some of the criminal activities, not the zoning activities, but some of the police enforcement activities. Are those admissible in that conversation, or are those off the table?
We won't be talking about that. We will be talking about the depth of the zoning violation.
Thank you.
No, that wasn't the question. It was whether that's admissible.
No.
It's not. Is it admissible that she knows him for similar violations at a different location? That can we point that out and make sure she remembers?
We should not. No. Each time an individual appears in front of a trier of fact.
She's not trying facts, she's trying to decide what the
fine
should be.
She is the trier of fact. So each time an individual appears in front of a trier of fact, that trier of fact is obligated to treat that individual from a clean slate. That's her obligation as a judge. And she's going to uphold that obligation. She has an obligation to be fair, not biased.
I have a question. The citation was for the concrete business. Would another citation then be issued for the lot splitting business?
Another citation will be issued for every violation of every zoning ordinance that is brought to the attention of the borough.
Has a citation been issued for the lot splitting business?
The only citation that has been issued as of today is the citation that we mentioned.
Will there be a citation?
I don't know. And I don't know if a log splitting business is taking place, so I can't answer that question.
George, are you able to answer?
And George cannot answer that question either, because he would have to confer with me first. So.
I'm going to allow one brief question, and then we're going to return to the order of our agenda.
Okay, thanks. So when this business receives their fine, of whatever that fine is, and pays the fine, what happens?
Then that citation is resolved, but that doesn't mean he can just go back and continue to. You can get a citation for every single day. So every single day that the operation continues, you can get a citation for it. So it could be $500 a day or $1,000 every day if you want to appeal each citation to the zoning hearing board. Each new occurrence can generate a new citation.
So you'll provide a citation each new occurrence
could result in a new citation.
How do we determine?
And what we've been saying is that the borough manager and the zoning code enforcement have been directed to keep be vigilant and to enforce the code. Mm-hmm. So, and they will be vigilant. We have said to the residents of Runnymede that we are sympathetic to what your concerns are, and we will continue to be vigilant about this.
We are also really aware of how frustrating this might be as people who have to endure this, and I know that it requires a high level of perseverance and endurance, but that is unfortunately a part of the legal process. So we are working with and for you. There's just so much, our hands are tied to some extent, but your frustration, I hear it, I see it, it's real. And I understand that that's something that has to be addressed. We're doing the best we can to address it. We're not ignoring it. It's very real.
But one comment to that. Vigilance, we submitted 3 weeks ago evidence regarding the log splitter, and you're saying you're not even sure of it. With all due respect, I'm just saying, so vigilance is questionable.
And
frustrating, right? Like, mm-hmm. Where do we go from here? And that came as a result of the last BZR meeting, where we were advised to call the second we heard the log splitter start up. And we discussed that at BZR. But again, so immediately after that meeting, evidence is provided, and we've not heard anything. Not a response, not a return email, not a phone call, not a visit. We provided authority to come onto our property to view at any time. And we've never had anybody come down to our property. Anyway, vigilance, I understand, and I'm appreciative. And that's why I'm saying, those were my opening remarks, that we're losing patience. And it's not because we don't believe in you. We're losing patience because actions are speaking louder than words. And that's where we're getting frustrated.
Thank you for that.
And I have a question about timing. This citation that has just been issued, now January, was from one day that he was running his business in November. So that is how many months later that is now being issued.
Well, there's a process, and we
understand the process too. Right. But no, come the springtime, he's going to be running his business every single day.
There could be a citation for every single day that he's running.
And he's going to be, but it's going to take 2 months to issue one citation.
Yeah, the borough doesn't know. You're right, Tom. Thank you, because we're not getting that follow up every single day.
Why?
We are not going to send email blasts about that.
No, it's not blasts.
Well, you know what?
That's not funny.
Could you explain why there was only one citation issued?
Because there was only one occurrence of evidence that was provided to the borough that rose to the level of running a business. Mr. Lott had a specific conversation with in a public meeting and with Mr. Glass. And in that conversation, he said Mr. Glass was working on a project in the township that we knew about. And Mr. Locke told him, if you bring the materials back from that job and I could see those materials being brought back to my job, I would consider that running a business out of your home, and I will issue a citation. Not 3 or 4 days later, we received evidence that he did that, that he brought materials from a job site back to his residence, and that was conclusive evidence that he was running a business out of his home, and a citation was issued.
You can walk past his house on any given day and see evidence that he's running a business out of it, a concrete business Why aren't we walking past his house
every day?
Right. Why haven't we walked past his house since August? There should have been, since August to now, should add up to what?
Is that J.C. Glass?
Mm-hmm.
What's four times concrete business? I mean,
there's not enough evidence.
Well, I mean, he just did the funeral home on Cedar Street.
That's where he was issued the citation. How does code enforcement interpret what the code says about evidence for running a business?
With no insurance.
And so what we are looking for is specific evidence. And when we have that evidence, we will follow through with it. There are many instances all around the borough of people conducting business in their homes, and it does not have an impact on their neighbors. And so that impact is what we're looking for, and that is open to interpretation. And so we have to apply the standard of interpretation that we would apply to any house, any one of your houses where you might be running a business. We have to apply it in this case as well. We have confidence in the judgment of our manager and our solicitor. We, as Councilor McGlan just mentioned, we hear the frustration, we are sympathetic to it, we are vigilant in paying attention to it. And it is going to take some time.
So one final note, just for the public. We determined through this process that he has no business license, he never filed business privilege tax, and he's the only insurance we ever received evidence of is inferior to the required code. Again, I just want to make sure.
That was submitted after he started work on the McGoldrick property.
Thank you for your comments. The matter of tax collection is under investigation.
I will say this, because there is a particular interest, when a hearing date is scheduled, we'll make the announcement. I don't know how.
That seems like a good opportunity.
I don't know how.
Well, if it's a public meeting, an email blast.
Well, it's a court proceeding. It's not a public meeting.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
I don't know how we'll communicate that.
We'll figure out a way to communicate that.
Court proceeding is a public hearing.
The parties that are involved in this intimately know definitively. So we'll find a way of making sure that you find out when it is.
Yeah. Thank you.
And actually, probably the judge, calling the judge's office would accomplish that?
It would. I mean, but you have to call every day.
Okay.
So.
All right. That's it.
I got a story to tell you.
Okay. I'm going to move on to committee reports. Thank you all. I just want to thank you all again for coming out and for making your views and opinions known.